Hello, my name is Stefan Frank and I will be talking about bilingualism, neural networks and structural priming. Structural priming or syntactic priming is the well-known phenomenon that a sentence is easier to perceive or to produce when it is preceded by a sentence with the same syntactic structure. This also happens when the two sentences are in different languages. What are the mechanisms that underlie structural priming, and are these mechanisms any different for between language than within language priming? Some answers to these questions were provided by neural network simulations. They've shown that structural priming could be a mere side effect of the error-driven learning of processing a sentence, and that there's no reason to think that any different mechanisms or representations are needed for between language than within language priming. We've shown this using Franklin Cheng's dual path model, which is a recurrent neural network based model of word by word sentence processing that was developed for the monolingual case. And Cheng already showed that this model displays syntactic priming if it is trained with an additional sentence with a particular structure. So this training for priming is exactly the same as training for simply learning to produce sentences. In our group, Gerard Soukola developed a bilingual version of this model by simply providing it with two languages and some minimal language control that was needed so that the model would produce either one language or the other. And Jung-Hoo showed that this bilingual dual path model displays syntactic priming of active and passive structures, exactly like the monolingual priming does, and it does so both within and between languages. Now, one drawback is that this model can only be used for artificial miniature languages. It's really hard to scale up, maybe even impossible to scale up, to large amounts of natural language. However, syntactic or structural priming in neural language models that are trained on large natural corpora has also been demonstrated. So Martin van Schijndel and Tel Linzen, they took a so-called long short-term memory recurrent neural network model that was trained for next word prediction on 90 million words of English Wikipedia. And they then tested it on garden path sentences, such as the soldiers warned about the dangers. So when this who were is not here, at first it seems that warned is a main verb. But then if the sentence continues with conducted, it turns out that in fact the soldiers were warned about the dangers. And of course, that leads to a garden path effect in human readers compared to the case where who were is provided. The model also showed this garden path effect. A surprisal of this critical verb here at the end was higher in the reduced relative condition, that is the ambiguous condition, than in the unambiguous condition. More importantly, they showed that the model displays structural priming. If this trained model was trained a bit more on some extra reduced relative sentences, then the garden path effect decreased, mirroring human reading time data. Now, will this also work between languages? For this, we need a garden path structure that is the same in two different languages. And we use the so-called noun phrase sentence coordination ambiguity. And this is based on a conjunction with the word and, which leads to a local ambiguity between a noun phrase and a sentence clause interpretation. As in, the thief shot the jeweler and the cop. At this point, it makes sense to think that the thief shot two people. But then if the sentence continues with a verb, it turns out that in fact, this end signals the start of a new sentence clause. So this verb here disambiguates the local ambiguity. Of course, you can insert a comma and then there's no ambiguity. The thief shot the jeweler, comma, then it's clear that an S coordination will follow. Now, the nice thing is that this works exactly the same in Dutch as in English. And in fact, the first experiments on this were done in Dutch by John Hooks and colleagues. They showed in the reading times that there is, of course, a garden path effect. So the reading time on this disambiguating verb is longer in the ambiguous than in the unambiguous condition. And they also showed there was an interaction with semantics. If the S coordination is semantically implausible, there is still a garden path effect, but it is weaker than in the semantically more reasonable condition. An LSTM language model trained on Dutch showed both the ambiguity effect and this interaction with semantics. So here we have a good start to extend this model to a bilingual one and see if it can display within and between language structural priming. So we took this LSTM language model and trained it on English and Dutch, about 9 million sentences of each, for a total of over 250 million words. And as you can see here, the number of word types in the combined training corpus is about 4,000 less than the sum of word types in the individual corpora. And that is, of course, because some of the words are shared between English and Dutch. Whenever two words have the same spelling, because maybe they're cognates or false friends or loan words, then they got a single input node. They shared an input node in the model as well as an output node. So that's why the number of input and output nodes is only 36,000 and not over 40,000. Now, after training, this model was tested on all the items from the Hooks et al. Study, 120 of them, in both their ambiguous and the unambiguous condition, so comma or no comma, and in the original Dutch as well as in English translation. For simplicity, we just ignore the semantic manipulation in this experiment. The size of the garden path effect is the difference in critical verb surprisal between the ambiguous and the unambiguous condition. But before measuring this garden path effect size, we did syntactic priming in the model by training the model on each one of these of the other 119 items, again in 2x2 conditions, ambiguous, unambiguous, and the same language or different language as the target sentence. And after each priming sentence presentation, the network weights were reset to what they were before the priming, so that these are really 119 fully independent tests. And what do we find? First of all, there is a garden path effect, but we already knew that, at least for Dutch, from the earlier simulations. But it also works in the bilingual model, apparently. So there's a positive garden path effect here. And there is clearly a structural priming effect. So after an unambiguous prime, the garden path effect is much stronger than after an ambiguous prime. And this works both within language as between languages. And it is actually a bit stronger within and between languages, which matches the modeling results of Yong Ku and also most of the human experiments. So there are some experiments that show no significant difference between the two types of priming. But most studies show that between language priming is a bit weaker than within language priming. Now you might wonder how much of this depends on the assumption that words with the same spelling share a representation. So what happens when we relax that assumption by separating the vocabularies? So these are exactly the same results as in the previous slide. Now in this experiment, each of the words was prefixed with a language tag so that automatically the network will assign a new node to it. So there's different nodes for the Dutch version and the English version of a word that have the same spelling. So the vocabulary is separated. And still there is a between language priming effect, even though it's a bit weaker. So this means that the effect doesn't fully depend on this overlap between the vocabularies. Although it's possible to separate these things even more, because here only the words are prefixed with a language tag and not the punctuation. And the comma is very important, of course, to this garden path effect. So what happens if we also prefix the language, use the language tag for the comma, meaning that there is an English comma and a Dutch comma? Then is there still going to be syntactic priming? Turns out, yes, but it's really, really, really tiny. So here it might seem that there's actually no difference between ambiguous and unambiguous primes between languages, but this very small difference is still statistically significant. So even when the vocabularies are totally separated so that even punctuation is different between English and Dutch, still there is this little bit of between language priming. Now we could wonder what this effect depends on. So Brenneken and Pickering, they noted that if there is some priming effect, then something about the representation between prime and target must be shared. And in syntactic priming, we tend to believe that this is evidence for shared representation of syntactic structure. In this particular experiment, it would mean that the S-coordination structure is somehow shared between prime and target, and also between Dutch and English. But when you think carefully about what the network really needs to learn, really needs to do, then it might be a lot simpler. So here is a prime example in the ambiguous and unambiguous condition. And here's an example of a target, again, in the ambiguous and unambiguous conditions, with protects here being the critical verb. Now, all the network needs to do for successful priming is increase the probability of the verb in the unambiguous condition after the unambiguous prime, and decrease the probability after the in the ambiguous condition. And likewise, after an ambiguous prime, the probability of the verb in the ambiguous condition needs to increase, and in the unambiguous condition needs to decrease. So all it needs to learn is, if there's a comma, then increase the occurrence probability of a verb. And likewise, if there's no comma, then decrease the occurrence probability of the verb, at least in the ambiguous condition, of course. So does that mean that the only thing the network needs to share in representation is a verb category? If it has a notion of verb that is shared between primes and targets, and that is shared between Dutch and English, then it would be able to do cross-linguistic structural priming. So what I did is take all the word embeddings, the 300 dimensional vectors that are learned by the network and that represent each of the word types, and then perform a multidimensional scaling so that it can be visualized to see whether there is some sort of clustering between verbs and non-verbs and between Dutch and English. So this is the result. And what you can clearly see here is that indeed the verbs, so that's the blue and red dots, are represented somewhat differently from non-verbs in gray here. So there is some clustering that shows that the network has learned a notion of verbness. Also, there's some clustering between the Dutch verbs in blue and the English verbs in red. By the way, this is in the shared vocabulary conditions, and importantly, because of Dutch morphology, there is no homographs between English and Dutch verbs, so there's never any ambiguity about whether a verb is in English or in Dutch. Now, importantly, the clustering between Dutch and English verbs seems to be a bit weaker than between verbs and non-verbs, which would suggest that indeed the network has learned not only an abstract notion of verbness, but also that this verbness is shared between Dutch and English. But let's see if we can quantify that a bit. How could we do that? Well, we want to know how strongly the words of one set are separated from those of another set. And to measure this, we take the average embedding distance between all word pairs of the joint set and between all word pairs where one word is from one set and one is from the other set. And the difference between these average distances, that quantifies the amount of separation between set X and set Y. And when we do that for verbs versus non-verbs, we see indeed a pretty good separation. So the network has learned a difference between verbs and non-verbs. The average distance, difference in distance between English and Dutch verbs is also positive, so it has also learned to separate English and Dutch verbs, but this separation is clearly weaker than the separation of verbs and non-verbs. So non-verb separation is stronger than English-Dutch verb separation. In other words, the network has learned something about verbness that is somewhat language independent. Also note that this difference becomes smaller as the vocabulary is more separated between languages, which suggests that indeed it is this verbness notion that drives the syntactic priming. To conclude, a bilingual LSTM does display cross-linguistic structural priming when trained on a large natural language corpus, again showing that error-driven learning could be a mechanism behind structural priming, and that bilingualism is not special in this case. It doesn't require any special mechanisms to explain between language priming compared to within language priming. The network did this by discovering a language independent approximate verb category, and even when the vocabularies are fully separated, it still works, which is interesting because the training task can easily be optimized by functioning as two monolingual networks, by totally separating all the English input words from all the Dutch input words. That would lead to the best results. Still, some cross-linguistic priming does still occur. So an English comma increases the probability of a Dutch verb, which means that the network has learned more than just a verb category. So perhaps, after all, it did learn something about NP and S coordination that is language independent.